Good evening. Welcome to everyone this Christmas Eve. It's good to be together. Good to see all of you, at least half of your faces. But it is wonderful to be together to honor the Lord this Christmas Eve. Let's stand as we prepare our hearts for worship. Just an audible for the slides. We are going to start with He Who Is Mighty, as it is in the order of worship.
True.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Please be seated.
Hallelujah. The King is exalted. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We'd like to welcome all of you who are here joining us in person and those who are connecting with us online as well. Thank you for being with us this evening in this night of worship. This is a service of worship as we turn our hearts and reflect on the meaning of Christ's birth through scripture and song. And the message this evening is based on the passages in Luke, from Luke 2, that we will be reading all throughout the night. There's a video.
She's pregnant and she's
going to
have a baby.
Do you remember what city they went to?
Bethlehem.
Bethlehem, that's right. And what happened when they got to Bethlehem?
They went to a stable.
A stable. And what's a stable?
Yes.
It's
a farm. That must have been itchy.
Your wife was it itchy?
Was
oh, they put filled with hay. Why did they have to go to Bethlehem to have the baby?
I don't think they stayed in a place with a hospital.
So they had to go to Bethlehem?
Yeah. On a camel. No, a donkey.
Okay, it was a donkey?
Yeah.
Okay, so they went on a donkey to Bethlehem because it had a hospital.
A donkey had a hospital?
What's Christmas about?
It's about Jesus being born and then the shepherds come because they see the star.
What kind of star? They just see a star in the sky or?
It's like a plus sign.
It's the X marks the spot because if you turn it that way, it's an X and you find the treasure in Jesus.
Let's back up a little bit.
What did you say?
Back up.
No, I mean, you don't have to back up. Who told the shepherds about Jesus?
Angels.
What do you think the angels look like?
I know. They look like flying butterflies.
Oh, wow. What did the angels sing?
Go to the bathroom.
Can I go to the bathroom?
Sure. So, what did the wise men do?
Bring gifts.
Do you know what they brought? Let's see.
Baby toys for baby Jesus.
They brought Jesus baby toys. What other things do you think they brought?
Gold, money, and...
So they brought mud.
I got one
that starts with an N.
Merchandise.
Okay. So gold and merchandise. Why do we still celebrate the birth of Jesus even today?
Because he's my savior.
And so that's why we still celebrate Christmas?
Yeah. It's a long story.
Merchandise. Yes. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, as we bow before you, we do come to you in Jesus' name, and we're thankful this evening for the story of his birth and the opportunity we have as your people to celebrate his birth and that he was born for us. And we ask, Lord, that you would help us as we reflect on your word, Lord, as we lift up praises to you in song, Lord, help us to recognize your presence here among us. And thank you. Thank you for being with us. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. the birth of our Lord and the story from the Gospel of Luke. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Let us go in heart and mind.
Together.
Oh, yes, let's stand this responsive reading. Let us go in heart and mind. Let us go with the shepherds. Let us go to find God's promise born to us. Oh. Okay, I read you read the bold part. I read the other portion. Let us go with the poor and humble. Let us go to all the world, to all peoples, all nations. Amen. O come, all ye faithful.
Oh, come on.
be seated. Oh, no, wait a minute. There's a responsive reading here. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was also God.
The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us.
We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you.
He is Christ the Lord.
In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. You are to give him the name Jesus.
Because he saved his people from their sins.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given.
And the government will be on his shoulders.
He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you.
He is Christ the Lord.
When the time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under law.
To redeem those under law, that we might receive the full rights of sons.
You are to give him the name Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
Living in a world that's seeking peace on earth, we all know that we're all needing peace on earth. Angels sit down from on high,
And there were shepherds living out in the field nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people."
Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests."
Oh,
Tonight's offering is for the Mercy Ministry of Grace's deacons and deaconesses. And it's in their work, they assist our congregation and the community in help. The deacons over the years have helped, and on behalf of Grace Church, has helped families stay in their homes, help people keep power in their house, help them maintain food. A number of things that the deacons that happen through the deacons. And so you can give to the offering this evening, unless it's designated otherwise, it goes to the Ministry of Mercies through the deacons. Checks and cash may be placed in the offering boxes at the rear of the sanctuary or over there at the rear of the APR, in that area where you're worshiping. And you can give also on gracedover.com. Or you can give by texting the word mercy and the dollar amount to 84321.
Was a cold sky above.
noble Joseph at her side, calloused hands and weary eyes. There were no midwives to be found on the streets of David's town in the middle of the night. So he held her and he prayed, shafts of moonlight on her face. For the baby in the womb, he was the maker of the moon. He was the author.
The birth of Jesus is an event in history unlike any other, yet it takes place in real time amidst the ordinariness of life's struggles in order to bring deliverance. Luke opens his account of Christ's birth with these words, "In those days." He said a mouthful with those words. And any one of his readers would recall those days as oppressive, restrictive, absurd, and exhausting, kind of like 2020. The details he gives are ones that we can all relate to. Because who hasn't questioned the policies that are sent down from governmental leaders? Who hasn't had trouble trying to get a room when something unexpected came up while traveling? What couple expecting a child hasn't had their plans changed in a moment because the baby is coming? And we've all got these stories. And looking back, and we might begin with, "In those days." You see, it's memory. It's also, in this world, ordinary. And that's what's too easily missed about the birth of Jesus. Yeah, it was not a silent night. He came into our world and joined us in the ordinariness of life's struggles. From taxes to census taking to the turmoil of travel, Jesus joins us in the seemingly unending mundaneness of our existence. In those days, with everybody coming to town because the emperor has decreed that you be counted in the place where your family is from, and your soon-to-be wife is giving birth to a baby that's not yours, how would you provide care? See, Joseph's family goes back a long ways. All of them are there in town. All of them are looking back to King David, an all but forgotten hero king whose victories are legendary. What woman wouldn't want to be the one in the lineage to give birth to the promised Messiah, David's royal son? And Mary has the story. I'm giving birth to the Messiah. Who can she tell? Who's going to believe that? Joseph and Mary got the revelation who this baby would be. And in those days, yeah, many babies were born to become a king. But this birth is a king who becomes a baby. He's born the Ancient of Days. He's born the Everlasting Father. In the midst of oppression, taxation, prejudice, and injustices, he's born the Prince of Peace. Isaiah 9:6, Isaiah foretold it. He said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Now, Joseph and Mary, his parents to be, had this honor. Yet, in those days, there's no room for him. So he's born in a cave where the animals are kept. He's laid in a feeding trough. The animals would have provided warmth, but they also provided their exhaust. And you thought your life stinks. Look at where Jesus, the Savior, is born, in a manger. And the scripture says, he is the child born for us. He's the son given to us. And in those days, that is great news. This is good news. Luke writes in verse 10 through 12, "But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.'" Why is this good news? I mean, children are born all the time. And sometimes children are born in unusual places too. I mean, we've heard the stories of children being born in the bathroom and left in the toilet. That happened a few years ago in a Burger King. Or they were born and then placed in a dumpster. But even in these days, that's not good news. Why is this good news? Well, it's because this is a Savior who is the Lord's anointed. He is the Messiah. And how will the shepherds know? How will they know that they found him? And the sign, the angel says, it's the location of his birth. Well, what's important about that? Well, Luke, he's writing to first century readers who are living under the rule of the Roman Empire. And the terms that are used for Jesus are terms that are used during the celebration of the Roman emperor's birth. Savior and Lord are designations given to Caesar as the pagans would celebrate his birthday. Craig Keener, in his commentary on these verses, he points out that Jesus' birth in a lowly manger distinguishes the true king from the Roman emperor, whose loyalists in Luke's day would have bristled at and perhaps responded violently to the implicit comparison. Well, now you know why the angel says, "Do not be afraid." I mean, yeah, an angel appearing to you, that would be scary. That's a reason to be afraid. Yeah, but not only that, not only is that a reason to be afraid, but because what they were saying could cause an insurrection. It could start a riot. And the sign, the Greek word there is simeon, and it means an unusual occurrence, transcending the common course of nature. So it's not the usual course of nature for the master, the Lord, the Kyrios, to be born in a place where the animals leave their droppings. In those days, this is the sign that the shepherds would have about the Messiah and the Lord. This is good news. Your maker, your creator, there he is in a manger. In those days, this was an inversion of power. In those days, this was a message to the humble that you are being exalted by God. In those days, it was a message to the highborn, or at least those who thought that they were born with something more than anyone else, that if the everlasting Father will humble himself and be born in a manger for us, then you better get off your high horse. See, in those days, this was a message not to look for the Lord's help in miraculous, spontaneous deliverances, but to know that he's with us when we are in the midst of life's excrement. Perhaps that's the way we should see 2020. For all of its trouble, for all of its anxieties, for all of its dashed hopes and losses, look, the Savior is for us since he is with us. Perhaps in these days, we often find it difficult to comprehend how complicated and puzzling life can be with all of its seemingly random events and circumstances, and then to reconcile these things with the idea of the existence of a sovereign God who loves. And by the way, if he is love, wouldn't you expect him to join you in your suffering? Wouldn't you expect him to make sense of the details of your life, and not just yours, but the lives of millions? We let the Christmas story, in these days, we let the Christmas story remind us that God is at work in the puzzle of this world. Have you ever seen these puzzles where on one side you have on the piece you have the picture of the puzzle, but on the back it's not gray, it's another puzzle. On the other side it's another puzzle. So as you're doing the puzzle, you're forced to think and to keep both pictures in mind. And when you finish putting it together, you have two pictures in one puzzle. It's as if two worlds are coming together. See, that's what faith in Christ is like. God is at work in every piece of the puzzle. Whatever your struggles, from the trouble with politics of the day to censuses and taxes and the perils of travel, the struggles with racism and prejudice, God is at work in all of the puzzle to bring to us the missing piece, a baby who is born the Ancient of Days. He's the child of Bethlehem who's born the everlasting Father and Prince of Peace. He brings heaven and earth together. And you and I have peace in Christ because he's born in a cave. He's buried in the grave. He sanctifies the womb and the tomb and everything in between. God has given to us another sign as well, another unusual occurrence transcending the common course of nature. You say, where is that? Well, it's in the Lord rising from the dead on the third day. Do you notice in the story of Christ's birth and the story of his death, Jesus is wrapped in strips of cloths? Luke 2:7 says she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. See, he's wrapped in cloths and placed in a manger. That's his birth. And then the second time he's wrapped in strips of cloths, it's because he, the everlasting Father, has died. And do you know what these two events have in common? They both evoke faith. The shepherds in Luke 2 go to the manger and they see the wrapped child and believed that Christ is for us. That's their testimony. They go back and this is what they tell, everything that the Lord had done, all that they had seen. The disciples go to the grave and they see the Lord unwrapped and they believed Christ has freed us. In John 20, verses 6 through 8, then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, and as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They see, in these days, like those days, you and I are being called to believe the King who became a baby, Christ the Lord. He's bound with us so that one day he might free us from bondage. Hallelujah. See, Jesus, God's gift, is wrapped and unwrapped so that we can know that he is with us from beginning to end. At his birth, there is no room for him. He's restricted to a cave for us. At his death, Christ dies to make room for us beyond the grave. He says, I am going, in John 14, 2 and 3, I am going there to prepare a place for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Brothers and sisters, you'll not make sense of the puzzle of this life until you place your faith in Jesus Christ. If you haven't done that, do so. And if you are, if you have, oh, continue to tell one another the story. As you sit around tomorrow and you're unwrapping gifts, yeah, and you're telling the story, tell the story of Christ who was wrapped for us and then unwrapped. Because Christmas reminds us that Jesus joined us in the puzzle of this world, and he fills in the missing, pun alert, piece, P-E-A-C-E. Trust him. Amen.
Let's stand together as we continue to celebrate our Lord's birth and worship together. Okay. We got a scripture reading first, do we not? Very good. Very good. Thank you. Yeah.
Shook me up, Jeff.
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them of this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart.
The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Let's stand together in songs of hymns of praise. Thank you.
Hear the benediction. Jesus is the Word made flesh among us. May his incarnation fill our hearts with peace.
Lord,
Jesus is the promised Savior born of Mary. May his birth to us renew your hope.
Lord,
Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. May the gift of his presence bring forth great joy. Now may the Father of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Christ our Lord, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Merry Christmas, everyone. Wait for the ushers to dismiss you from the rear to the front. Remember to social distance and give somebody the right elbow of fellowship. Go in peace.
Hey.